6 6 9 6 6 9 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 6 236. All you like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. Christ the Lord became obedient unto death. Together we pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned in heart, word, and deed. We have that love with all our heart. We have that love our neighbors as ourselves. We have that love ourselves as we ought. We pray you, O mercy. Forgive us all that is past, and grant we may serve you in newness of life. To the glory of the Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Together let us pray. Almighty God, look graciously, we pray, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into hands of sinners, and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. We sit for the meekness.
Of my people. people, the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked, and his tomb with the rich. Although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth, yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his wife an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring, and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion of the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death, and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet, he bore the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
Overtaken me, and I cannot see.
They are more in number than the hairs on my head, and my heart fails me. Be pleased, O Lord, to deliver me. O Lord, make haste to help me. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 10, reading from verse 16 to 25. This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts. I will write them on their hands. I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of deeds, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who has promised is faithful, and let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Divine.
So holy,
the Lamb's
Divine.
the passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John chapter 19, beginning at verse 1. Then Pilate therefore took Jesus and scourged him. And the soldiers planted a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they put him on him a purple robe and said, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they smote him with their hands. Pilate therefore went forth and again said unto them, "You will not bring forth him to you, that ye may know that I find no fault in him." Then came forth Jesus, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. And Pilate said unto them, "Behold the man!" When the chief priests, therefore, and the officers saw him, they cried out, saying, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said unto them, "Take ye him and crucify him, for I find no fault in him." The Jews answered, "We have a law, and by our law he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God." When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he was more afraid, and again went unto the judgment hall, and said unto Jesus, "From where art thou?" Jesus gave him no answer. Then Pilate said unto him, "Speakest thou not unto me? Knowest thou not that I have power to crucify you, and have power to release you?" Jesus said, "Thou couldst have no power at all against me, except it were given to you from above. Therefore, he that delivered me unto you had the greater sin." And from then on, Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out, saying, "If thou let this man go, thou art not Caesar's friend. Whosoever maketh himself a king speaketh against Caesar." When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he brought Jesus forth and sat down in the judgment seat in the place that is called the pavement, but in Hebrew, Golgotha. It was the preparation of the Passover. At about the sixth hour, he said unto the Jews, "Behold your king!" But they cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Then Pilate said unto them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." Then they delivered him therefore unto them to be crucified. And they took Jesus and led him away. And he, being his cross, went forth to a place called the place of his skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him and two others with him, on the other side of one, and Jesus in the center. And Pilate wrote a title, he put it on the cross, and the writing was this: "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." The title then read, "Many of the Jews And for the place where Jesus was crucified was near to the city. It was written in Hebrew and in Greek and in Latin. Then the chief priests of the Jews went to Pilate. Went not the king of the Jews. But he said, I am the king of the Jews. Pilate answered, what have I written, I have written. Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts to every soldier a part, and also his coat. Now the coat was without seam, woven from the top throughout. Then said they for among themselves, let us not tear it, but cast lots for it. Whose shall it be? That the scripture might be fulfilled, which said, they parted my raiment among themselves, and from my vesture they did cast lots. These things, therefore, the soldiers did. Now they stood by the cross of Jesus, his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciples standing by him, who would love him, he said to his mother, woman, behold thy son. Then said he to his disciple, behold thy mother. And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. Amen. Lord, grant that the words that shall be spoken in the rest of our lives, for we ask. Every Good Friday, amongst many things, I like to know the story of the man who said, the preacher who said, today is Friday, Pilate is on his throne. Today is Friday, Pilate is on his throne. Today is Friday, Pilate is on his throne. Sunday is coming. And King Jesus shall be on his throne. Sunday is coming when King Jesus will be on his throne. Sunday is coming when King Jesus is on his throne. Amen. So every Good Friday, more so we set aside to reflect upon the cross. Since we're not having a funeral service, and one of my colleagues said he announced no funeral service, but his service will last about that time. So he conditioned his mind, and he was saying to me as a colleague of mine, he conditioned the people to just sit still. So today, the day of our days, I start by saying first, why the cross of Jesus is an offense. Why the cross of Jesus is an offense. One, the cross of Jesus says to every one of us, you see, you know, the whole of us are sinners. We are all sinners. Need repentance, need to be rescued, need to be saved, all of us. Secondly, why the cross is an offense? Because on the cross, the blood of Jesus was shed. On the cross, the blood of Jesus was shed. On the cross, the Lamb of God, that first Lamb, the sacrificial Lamb, the blood was shed to bring about our forgiveness, the forgiveness for humankind. Once and for all, that sacrifice, that sacrificial Lamb, worthy, supersede all the lambs before and brings about the finality of the shed blood. Thirdly, why the cross of Jesus is an offense? Because it sets forth an ideal for life. An ideal for life. Because we recognize that our sins are forgiven, it drives us into a new way of living. So Paul says, if any person is in Jesus Christ, the person is a new creation, a new person. And fourthly, why the cross is the offense? Because it speaks of the power of God. The power of God. The power of God unto salvation. The power of God unto salvation. So, what I'm going to do now, what we are going to reflect upon now, is trying in a nice little way to reflect upon the seven words from the cross, briefly, not 3 hours, and see how we can tie them in the space of time that we have. The first word, Jesus said, forgive them, for they know not what they have done. What a wonderful thought, and we must remember this. Any sin can be forgiven. Father, forgive them. You have heard many of you know, I have said before, the most beautiful person is a forgiven person. But look at the Old Testament lesson, and I hope that you really make it sink in. We get part of the gist of the forgiveness there. You remember Simon Peter came to Jesus and said, Jesus, tell me something. How shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? And then, like many people, he quickly moved to answer the question according to his own mind and thinking. Jesus, tell me my brother shall forgive him. 70 times, sir. Jesus now got a chance to reply. Jesus said, no, 70 times 7. Which means and tells of the infinite number. Forgiveness is a must. Forgiveness is costly, but it is rewarding. And again, they look at the Old Testament blessing. And digest it. Because one of the saddest things about many church people, Christian people, is their inability to forgive. They always want to get even at somebody or the somebody or the somebody who have loved them. We all need forgiveness. Forgiveness, yes, from God, but we need forgiveness from each other. And we need to offer forgiveness to others. So we repeat, the most beautiful person is a forgiving person. Because the person recognizes, one, God has forgiven he or she. Therefore, the love of God has been shed abroad. Therefore, forgiveness reaches out to those around us. The LP, it's costly, but it's rewarding. So we can look the person who offended us in the eyes and they should look back at us and they should feel the new, let me put it this way, the new fresh air. Not the bad vibes, but the new fresh air, the new vibes flowing from God to us to them. From God to us to them. And what a wonderful feeling it is. There are some people, must remember, who refuse forgiveness. When we have forgiven them, it's not our fault. The same thing with many people. They refuse to accept God's forgiveness. And that's why the cross of Jesus is so important. Hey, see, I love you. I gave my son, the Lamb, for you, so that you are forgiven. Therefore, please forgive others. Painful as it may be, but we want it. Over the past couple of days, I keep getting into some little troubles, and people have been forgiven me, especially a couple of policemen. I was in the car, and the car was driving fast. And the car superseded the speed limit. And the car was stopped by the police. And the driver was addressed by the police. And to cut the story larger, the police said, "All right, boy, I feel glad." The driver felt glad and smiled. And the police smiled back at him. And he continued his way. And then the same driver took the car and touched somebody's car. No, somebody touched his car. When the driver looked at the person, like he could even buy a church mouse. So he said, "All right, go on, let me take you." Moving along, forgiveness is a must. For those who belong to Jesus, it's a must. It's not a may. It's not a might. It's a must. It's a, what the commands of Jesus. Second word, Jesus said, "Today shall thou be with me in paradise." Today shall thou be with me. Today shall thou be with me. Here we see. And have you ever stopped? I was reading somewhere. And the writer wrote, he said, one cross. Why there were crosses. Why there were just three crosses? And why was Jesus placed in the center and not on the other side? And the person goes on, the writer goes on, and he said, it seems as if this was all God's doing. Apparently this was, has never crucified any persons or any criminals like this. They just line them up and put them up, 16 of them on on Calvary. But this time, so it signifies even more, and it helps us remember even more that this death was extraordinary, special. So here, and I like to say this, I've said before, that the two criminals on either side of Jesus represent the two, you could call it personalities, the two characters that we have. One criminal, one of the criminals started. Jesus, you're powerful, you're good, and you know what things about you, how all your powerful acts. Why not just save us and save yourself? And the other one, so in other words, the quarrelsome nature of some of us, the warrior-fied nature of some of us. On the cross, the other side of Jesus, on the other side of Jesus. And the other side of Jesus, that criminal, he said, why are you troubling Jesus? If that do not know, Jesus did no wrong. What we have done, tell the things, and we deserve what we have done. And then he addressed the one who is the bringer of forgiveness, the one who is the bringer of salvation. He looked at him. He gazed at him. And he said in humility, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. What a wonderful thing. Jesus now said, today shall thou be with me in paradise. So we get that lovely picture, don't we? If we cry out to Jesus and ask his forgiveness, if we ask, set our faults, then Jesus is willing not only to forgive us, but to grant us a place in his kingdom. But we have to do something special. We have to admit our faults, our shortcomings. We move from being warrior-fied and quarrelsome and uncomplimentary, always complaining, always saying, is that our fault or somebody else's fault? And cutting that steel. When you look once again to the one who brings life, hope, forgiveness, peace, and joy, and the one who offers the invitation for all of us to enter the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, the place called heaven. So, Jesus at the center, and the two set of human beings, those who continue to refuse and reject, and even to just go and abandon the face of Jesus. On the other side, those who are willing to say, Jesus, you know my faults, I'm sorry. Remember me. Of course, I want to set apart that he recognized the kingdomness of Jesus. That is very straightforward. today shalt thou be with me in paradise. So moving along, the second, the third word. Woman, know thy son, son, know thy mother. I love this part. I love all of them. It is nice. It is wonderful. It is beautiful. It is lovely to belong to a family. Not true. Especially when the family is gracious and loving and caring and understanding and that shows a family by name. That shows a family. It is lovely. And you and I belong to two main families. The family that share our blood relationship. And the other family now, who by the blood of somebody else, Jesus is the somebody else, brought us into this new family. This family is an eternal family which moves and transcends from material, physical, into that what you call the spiritual family. Whereby we share in those things that are lovely, amen? Those things that are tender-hearted and compassionate of good report. We become new persons in this family. Hallelujah. New persons. And we have the common destiny. One day we shall all be in heaven. Even though at times some members of the family depart this phase of existence, we believe that we shall see them once again in God's place, heaven. That is why the family of God must be far different from the other family, that some of them are kill after one another, assassinate one another, especially over deadlift. And some families, earthly families, when they move in status in life, in material things, and even sometimes in educational things, in educational abilities and capabilities, they look down. They pass by the other family. So a lady said to me, "Father, see how husband, sir, I'm going to point this out. You see that the husband, sir, and the sister one. You see that the man and the sister one. I said, I have two more rounds, sir. But because me and my little one, guess what? She not talk to me. A woman, remember when the church, I'm lying, believing like that. Where was? We're moving on quickly. We've had to finish before the 3 hours, not true. So then, it is wonderful to be in, belong to a family. And Jesus committed Mary to John. And John to me. I was tempted to say that the truth, that sometimes someone spiritual family much better than the blood family. Not true, not true. Some of them. Move it along. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? My God, why? Why is a word that is not all the while we can get an answer for it? Why? For some of the things that we don't know and we can't get an answer, It drives us into faith, more faith. So even for us, we say, why certain things happen to us? It's not that we shouldn't say why, but we should say why based on the fact that we will not get the answer that we would like to get. But what we will do, we are asking for an increase of faith. Amen? An increase of faith, whereby the faith that we ask for increase will cause us to begin to face and survive even the worst tragedy. The worst tragedy, whatever the tragedy is, fire, disaster, COVID, why did someone leave us and gone? Why the bicycle broke down? Why the two legs never hurt us and the three knees have one way? Why? Can't get no answer. Why did some of the answers they were right in our faces? Why do they even prosper? Why do the wicked people prosper? And we the good people that prosper. But what is prosper? What is prosper? That's another question. So they will pray. When we say why this is happening, it's not that we should end up doubting, but it should mean that we ask for increase of faith and continued faith. Now, ever so often, when the tragedy of death hits us, so often our faith shakes. And sometimes we move from the girl's faith that we have. Because we say every Sunday when we meet for you finish. And I believe in the communion of the saints and the resurrection to life. We forget very often. The Bible says we live 3 score years and 10 we have, and sometimes we go longer than that. The Bible says it is appointed unto each one of us to die. The Bible says to number our days. And the Bible reminds us that Jesus said, I am with you always. So the tragedy of death sometimes will cause some of us to behave against the belief that we have and share. So I implore you, I beg you once again that when the tragedy of death hits us, especially those who we love, do not abandon Jesus. Do not abandon your faith. But pray for increase of faith amidst the pain that we feel for those who we love. The next word. I thirst. I thirst. It's interesting, very interesting about this. If I would have gone into the fact that Jesus, it is said, never ate anything for a few hours, well, the trial, the arrest, the trial, because you know, he had supper, eh? And the later after the supper, he went to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. And when he was praying, they came and they arrested him. Well, the secret's not really the same. the Garden of Gethsemane. But let us go back to there for a moment, the Garden of Gethsemane. It was the garden, firstly, of remorse and reflection, where Jesus knelt and he prayed, and he reflected and he prayed, and he took with him his three closest friends. They were closer to him as he prayed, as he reflected, as he reflected. And then he moved from the garden. After praying and all of that, move into the garden of victory. Because after he has prayed, he got up and he felt victorious now. Because he could see beyond the ridicule and the rejection, he could see the glory of the resurrection. Read by the garden, another garden was going to come. The garden of resurrection, which you could see. So he said, Jesus, get up now, brethren, because my accusers are right here. But me all right, me cool them, me, everything under control now. Me get the answer, I receive the answer. I know where I'm going, I know what I'm going to do. I know my death is not a death ordinary. My death was that destined by the Father to save humankind. So, we can so say, yes, it is finished. It is finished. You see, at the end of our lives, we can say, Lord, thank you. We feel fulfilled. It is finished. Thank you, Lord. I thirst. Thank you, Lord. It is finished. Thank you, Lord. I thirst after righteousness. I thirst after uncertainty. And so, Lord, I can say, it is finished. I can say, like Paul, I have fought a good fight. I finished my course. So, a time of two in a one, and now I close with the seventh word, the final word. Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. There comes a time in our lives that we have to let go and let God. There comes a time in our lives when we get very old. Some of us very ill. That we just have to let go of some of the things that we used to do. And some of us, even in our Christian pilgrimage, young as we may be, we have to let go, put off, let God, and put on. Put on. So if I have fought a good fight, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And we think of Stephen, the first Christian martyr, they say, in Acts chapter 7. When Stephen, he says, he was young, and they were going to stone him because he believed and preached Jesus. And he looked out to Jesus. He was a man full of grace and integrity and all that was good. And he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Just like the almost exact words like Jesus. Not exact, almost exact like Jesus. So today, we are here, we give thanks to God for the Lamb that was slain for us. And what the cross means to all of us. The availability of salvation and sins forgiven for all humankind. Don't take it lightly. Don't be like some others who have become so busy And they may find certain excuses. The second is your blindness. Don't neglect. They are still living. Or why some neglect the assembly of the saints? So we thank God for the day of days and what the cross of Jesus means to us. A sign of redemption. So, I am not afraid of the cross. And there are some people who don't have the cross. You know the cross, what we like? When we know it as Christians, it means more than just a pagan thing. Yes, when they want to argue, that's what they like to argue, like they have more sense than everybody else. Why are you in the cross? Jesus don't argue. You tell them, yes, you know that Jesus is not on the cross. But the cross is the symbol, it's the sign of our redemption. So every time we have it on, every time we see the cross, we remember. Here is a sign of redemption, the sign of victory, the sign of sins forgiven. The sign that reminds me, reminds us to forgive others. True, yes, it was a pagan sign, but the cross, no, the death of Jesus, it transforms the meaning of the paganism and brings us into that sign of victory, the sign of salvation. Hallelujah. So we're not afraid of the cross. I'm not afraid to make the sign of the cross. No pagan. I will not make it properly. Top to bottom, left to right. In this side I counter for Christ. Top to bottom, left to right. In this side I counter for Christ. Hallelujah. Amen.
Thank you.
you please to turn to page 238. 238. It's a solemn intercession. And the prayer would ask that we stand. Those who can stand, will please stand. The Lord of God, and the Father sent His Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but the world through Him might be saved, and that all who believe in Him might be delivered from the power of sin and death, and become heirs with Him in eternal life.
Let us pray for the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church of Christ throughout the world. For its unity in witness and service, for all bishops and other ministers and people who may serve, for our Lord Bishop, and for all people of this diocese, for all Christians in this community, particularly those about to be baptized, that the Lord may confirm His church in faith, increasing in love and deserves.
Almighty and everlasting God, by your Spirit, the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified. Receive our supplications and prayers, which we offer before you, for all members of your holy church, and never the synod of our church, we are in Jamaica. That in our vocation ministry, we will truly and devoutly serve you through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We pray for all the nations and people of the earth, and for those with authority among them, for Patrick, our Governor General, Andrew, Prime Minister, Mark, Leader of Opposition, all members of Parliament, God's help, may they seek justice and truth, and live in peace and comfort.
Almighty God, keep your prayer in every heart, the children of peace, and guide with your wisdom, both into a counselor for the nations of the land, that justice and peace may increase until the world is filled with the knowledge of your love through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for all who suffer and are afflicted in body and mind, for the hungry, the homeless, the destitute, and the oppressed, and all who suffer persecution or prejudice, for the sick, the wounded, the handicapped, and the disabled, for those in loneliness, fear, anguish, for those who face temptation, doubt, and despair, for the sorrowful and the bereaved, for prisoners and captives, and those in mortal danger, that God in His mercy may comfort and relieve them, and grant them the knowledge of His love, and stir up in us the will and patience to minister to their needs.
Gracious God, our loving Father, the comforter of our sorrow, the strength of our suffer, hear the prayer of those in misery and grief. In the afflictions, show them your mercy. Give us, we pray,
the strength to serve them for the sake of Him who suffered for us, our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Let us pray for all who have not received the gospel of Christ, for those who have not heard the saving gospel of Christ, for all who have lost their faith, for all whose sin has made them indifferent to Christ, for who actively oppose Christ, thy word or deed, for all who are enemies of the cross of Christ, and persecutors of his disciples, for all who in the name of Christ have persecuted others, that God will open their hearts to the truth and lead them to faith and obedience.
Most in the name of God, Father, Father, creator of the peoples of the earth, and lover of souls, have compassion on those who do not know you, as you have revealed yourself to my Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Let your gospel preach with grace and power to those who have not heard it, and bring them to your throne, those who have not astray, that there will be one flock under one shepherd, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for all places of education and learning. Let us pray for all engaged in promoting fostering education in schools, colleges, and universities, that all who teach in them may be endowed with knowledge, wisdom, and understanding, and may seek to be guided in all their acts, that students may accept with gratitude and humility the opportunities to use God's gift of mind and intellect, that the spirit of truth may enlighten their learning, enlarge their understanding, and inspire their growth in mature judgment.
Almighty and ever living God, our Father, you are the source of truth, and your Spirit leads us in your truth. You are the teach of our own in our schools and colleges and universities. We set free from every
thing that is hard and evil, and finding truth, they lead them to use it for the good of mankind, human life, and for your greater good.
Amen.
Let us commit ourselves to God and pray for His grace of the Holy Land, that with all who have departed this life and have died in the peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to God alone, may be accounted worthy to enter into the fullness of the joy of God and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection.
O God, our good Father, you are the God of our children, the power and eternal light. Look for the whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery, by the future working of your providence, carry out the tranquility of the plan of salvation. With all words, see and know that the Christmas were first born, and now you raise them, and Christmas shall grow old, and be more new. The things that have been brought to perfection, by whom to whom all things pertain, your Son Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and forever.
Amen.
The peace of
God also with you.
Yeah.
Lord, give it to you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and a joyful thing, always and ever to give thanks. Father Almighty, everlasting God. But you have praised you for the glorious death of your Son, Jesus Christ, upon the cross, who came to seek and to save us, and to make us new persons in your name. Amen. And as our Savior's daughter, so you we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but lead us from evil. But thine is the kingdom and the power of the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Sacrament may be to us a pledge of inheritance. The blessed hope that we have in him and finally attain the joys of the lasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We invite the children and any adult who wishes to come for prayer from the crusade, hymn number 3, at the cross, where first of number 3 and last, and then by silver blood, who within the root, the sacred death for such a one as I am. At the cross, where first of the sacred blood.
I'm
page 250, the rule book says, at the end of the service, no blessing or dismissal. So the president, you know, prayed this special prayer. The Lord be with you. God the love of the Father. Send down your abundant blessing upon all your children who have devoutly recorded the death of your Son. Ensure and certain hope of the resurrection. Grant them pardon. Give them comfort. Grant them peace. Grant them continued love. Grant them a peace of faith. May their faith be strong, grow. And eternal salvation, be assured. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now, some notices. We continue to observe Holy Friday, and you might preach about Holy Friday, and Holy Saturday, and then the grand prayer of the festival, Easter Day, and Sunday. We ask, try everything possible to attend service Sunday. We prophesy that tomorrow night, from 4 o'clock into the night, Satan will not bother you so much. I tell you, that dress you wear, no matter where it, that pants where you have been too tight, no matter where it, that hairstyle will look good, like father, like some of that mother. And they will talk about the person who come here with the dad, some of you, husband and wife, some of you children, are source of distraction for you not to come to the Creed of the festival. But you need to say the nice the prayer when all this generation comes. You just say it nice to get behind me. Amen. If the card put down, especially the white one, start walk from now. Amen. I will give everybody direction. Start walk from now. I said, we will come to church, Satan. Amen. All right. And then now, if you're a nurse or a doctor, the 10 places I want to see them, tell them you can't see them at the one time. So end up not seeing none of them until after church. Like this? We like that to you. Hey, thanks. Amen. When you're in, that's what I tell my father. When you're in. Nice, nice. Alright? But it's not nice to see you. Church is that nice. And tomorrow, nice to see you coming to church. Don't have that person, nice, very nice. And tomorrow, I'm going to order some. Well, respect. And we shall not get that. And all of them, nice to see you. See you Sunday? Amen. And I am told that we are ready to suffer over the church when we finish. No call to it. Because it's Lent. Amen? But if we can't tell what may happen, they may squeeze it with that card. Not for me. So we are making something over it. So please just tell it and pass it to you. Amen? Amen. Again, thank you all, everybody for coming. And all those who have done whatever you did, thanks. We ask your continued prayers for Mary, who lost her brother. Yesterday, the news got to her, and she tried to be strong. We know the feeling. We know the feeling, not true. And she nicely came down here, this man, and to set up things, which she was going to do. And then she got to country. Certain which country, but I asked her to go back some things for us, amen, especially for the minister. So pray for me and the rest of our family members. And guess what? No. So when you tell the mother, shh, and the mother dropped down. When I went back, by the way, she dropped down. You're fine, mother, I'm sure you give thanks. It's one of these things, you never can have a right answer for them, not true. Sometimes some people glad to hear. Some people they don't take it a little bit hard, not true. You never know. Alright? A friend of mine, brother in law died, and she thought the son didn't know. They were keeping it away from the son. Who lives in the United States. And she now took up the phone. The son is out there, as he said. I never called. But all you never tell me, sir, you have a Howard in church. A Howard cook better. All you never tell me, sir, your father did. And the boy said, where is that? Father! Why? And I remember stop crying 2 weeks ago. Some people take it hard. And after that, they show it. Amen. So grief, and this is why I preached a sermon some time ago. We all have to prepare that the person that we love, or the person that we love, they will take away from us. And I keep telling them, and I look at someone this morning, and I tell them that, the dresses that you must give to my family. So you get embarrassed to me, put them up back. So that when I die, you get enough. The hymn for the reception number 245. Thank you again, everybody. Glad to see you. The hymn 245. Where are the flowers? First of all, tomorrow evening. Where are the flowers?
Jesus.
No matter if you have no heart at all, Jesus, pray love.
Thank you.